Hello everyone, welcome back all of you. In today's session we are going to have discussion on LVDT, linear variable differential transformer. And before we proceed further, first let us recap whatever we had discussed yesterday. So yesterday we had a discussion on concept of variable reluctance, and based on that particular concept we were able to discuss three practical applications of it, one of which was a metal detector, then turbine flow meter, and then we had a discussion on tachometer as well. So the reason behind all these three practical applications, the concept of practicality was permeability is going to vary with respect to the medium. So if we are having the permeable medium as air, so we are going to have relative permeability as one. And if we are taking iron in a permeable medium, so the relative permeability of medium is going to be greater than one. So based on that, we were able to get the concept of relative permeability, and if the permeability of the medium is varying, we were able to understand that how the reluctance is going to vary. And as the conclusion of our previous session, we had these three formulas that reluctance is going to given as 1 by mu L by A. So if the permeability of the medium is increasing, if it is going from air to iron, so the relative permeability will increase, so the reluctance is going to decrease because they are inversely proportional. And then we had another formula, flux is going to be Ni by reluctance. So if the reluctance is getting decreased, the flux will increase because they are inversely proportional. And then we had one formula of self-inductance as well. So the flux is directly proportional to the self-inductance. So combining all these three individual dependencies, we were able to get that if relative permeability of the medium is increasing, the reluctance is going to decrease. And if the reluctance decreases, the flux is going to improve. And if the flux is improving, the self inductance of the medium is going to improve. So based on direct connection with permeability and self inductance, we were able to get the concept of all these three practical applications. And one more thing, whenever there is only one coil, we will discuss the concept of self-inductance, whereas if there are more than one coil, we are going to discuss the concept of mutual inductance. So in this case, linear variable differential transformer, we are going to have discussion on concept of mutual inductance because there are more than one coil is involved in it. So first, let's have a look why we are actually calling it as a linear variable differential transformer, because the displacement which we are going to provide to the system as an input is going to be the linear one, and the differential terms comes because of the series opposition of the secondary binding. So because of that, differential term is going to come, and the transformer we are aware of, either it can step up the voltage or it can step down the voltage based on the primary and secondary number of windings. So LVDT is going to have one primary winding and going to have two symmetrical secondary winding in series opposition, and it is going to have one ferromagnetic core as well. So why we are using the series opposition, that let me explain first, and then we'll have a look of it in a detailed manner. So first let us have a look of what does it mean by series connection or series opposition connection. So first we'll have a look of series connection, why we are not actually making use of it and why actually we are preferring series opposition. So I am going to take three different scenarios. So this is our primary coil, and here we are going to have ferromagnetic core. So let us say if this particular core is at extreme position A, let's say two extreme positions are there, A and B, because this is a null position, and this particular core can displace up to position A downward or up to position B upward. So in the beginning, I am assuming the position of ferromagnetic core as at A, and in the second case I'll discuss it as at point C, and in the third case I'll take it as another extreme B. So the flux associated with the primary coil due to excitation is phi 1, and why not series we are discussing, right? So we have to make it in the series connection first. So this is going to be the series connection. The both the secondary bindings are connected in series pattern. So the flux associated with the primary is phi 1, and when there is no iron core, the flux phi 1 is getting distributed in phi 1 by 2 and phi 1 by 2, because both the series connection coils are identical. So now we'll have we'll insert the iron core in between those primary and secondary windings. And if we have our iron core at extreme A, it is going to increase some additional flux. So let us say that core, if it is coming in contact with this particular series coil, so it is going to add another flux as phi 2. So in this extreme position, the flux associated due to this iron core with this particular secondary winding is going to be zero, because it's not in relation with that, whereas it is at extreme point A. So in this particular second coil, it is going to add another flux phi 2. And in the second case, if this particular core is at point C, so the flux associated every time it is going to be increased by plus phi 2. So that particular phi 2 in this particular position, it is going to be distributed half half with the both the series. So it will become phi 2 by 2 plus phi 2 by 2. Though phi 1 by 2, phi 1 by 2 is always going to be there. It is not going to go anywhere. So based on the movement of the core, the another flux which is getting added phi 2 is going to get distributed among those secondary bindings. And in the case of position B, if it is at extreme position B, the complete flux phi 2 due to iron core is going to get added to the first coil. So this will become as phi 1 by 2 plus phi 2, and flux associated with the downward coil will become as 0, because in that case the core will be at this particular position. So if we have a look of series opposition, series connection, so we are going to calculate the total flux. So the total net flux in all the cases we will have to add. So phi 1 by 2 plus phi 1 by 2 is going to be phi 1 plus 0 plus phi 2 is phi 2. And in this case, phi 1 by 2 plus phi 1 by 2 is again phi 1, and phi 2 by 2 plus phi 2 by 2 is going to be phi 2. And in this particular case also, phi 1 by 2 plus phi 1 by 2 is phi 1, and phi 2 plus 0 is phi 2. So as we can see, either core is at position A or at center or at extreme position B, in all these three cases we are not going to get any significant variation in the net flux. So due to which we will not be able to understand that at which particular position the core is. So that's why we are not making use of series connection. Rather, we'll go with series opposition. So when the core is at center at this particular point, when there is we are assuming initially when there is no core, if there is no core, the flux phi 1 will get distributed half of, and when there is iron core is present, the relative permeability of medium is going to change, and due to this it is going to get another it is going to add another flux phi 2. So if it is at position null position at position C, so that phi 2 is going to get distributed between both of these coils as half of. So phi 1 by 2 plus phi 2 by 2, and phi 1 by 2 plus phi 2 by 2. And when core is at extreme position A, so the flux associated with this particular coil will be phi 1 by 2 plus 0, and this will have phi 1 by 2 plus phi 2, because the flux phi 2 is going to completely get associated with the lower coil. And in the case B, the flux phi 2 will get associated completely with the upper coil, as we discussed earlier. So this is going to become 0. The flux associated in this coil will become as 0. And now if we wish to have the total net flux, so there we were adding, because this is in series connection, but here it is series opposition. So phi net is going to be phi 1 total flux associated here minus total flux associated here. So every time this phi 1 by 2 minus phi 1 by 2 plus phi 2 by 2, this term is always going to be get cancelled, and these both are equal, so this will become 0. And in this case, phi 1 by 2 minus phi 1 by 2 is going to get cancelled, and this will come as minus phi 2. And in this particular case, it will get cancelled, and this will come as phi 2 minus 0 is phi 2. So as we can clearly see the effect now, if the core is at center, we are going to get net flux as zero. If the core it has extreme position A downwards, it is going to give the negative net flux as minus phi 2. And if the core is at position B, at extreme upward position, the flux is going to be, net flux is going to be plus phi 2. So by moving the ferromagnetic core between the primary and secondary windings in a linear fashion, we are going to get the linear output voltage. It will vary from minus E to plus E. If it is, I am taking it as a reference point x equal to 0, and if the core is at position A, so this is going to be negative displacement minus x. So in that particular case, we are going to get the negative net flux, and due to which we are going to get negative output voltage. And if the core is at position B, we are going to have the positive displacement, positive x, and we are going to get the output voltage as positive E. So that's how we are able to get the some effect which we can really sense in our practical application, and we can make use of it if we are using the series connection. So now we'll have the discussion on merits of LVDT and how we are actually implementing in the practical applications. So having understanding of working principle of LVDT and its construction, we can discuss about the merits of LVDT, that it is going to be a zero frictional instrument because there is no contact between the core and the coil, so lifetime is going to be more. And the second one is, it is a bidirectional displacement sensor because we are able to detect the negative displacement as well as positive displacement with respect to the null point. And it is used as a best industrial secondary sensor, and this particular sensor will help us understand the relation between the sensors and the industrial instrumentation. So I have drawn three practical applications where we can make use of LVDT. So in the first case, let us assume there is cantilever beam, and if we are applying a force on it, this is going to deflect downward. So the core of LVDT is connected to the cantilever beam. If it's deflect downwards, the displacement is in core is going to take place. So this secondary sensor will give the output with proportional to the force applied on the cantilever beam. And in the another case, the example I have taken as rotameter. Usually rotameter is having direct indication at the site itself, but if we wish to have the indirect indication with the help of LVDT, we wish to measure the displacement, or we wish to know the position of particular float in the rotameter, we can connect it with the core of our LVDT, and if the rotameter is moving upward or downward, this displacement in the core is going to take place, and we will be able to sense with the help of our secondary sensor as LVDT. And in the another case, I have taken the example of diaphragm, as we discussed earlier in the case of capacitive sensor microphone, where we are with the help of vibration, we are able to understand how much amount of voltage it is going to give. So in this particular case also, instead of capacitive sensor, we can make use of LVDT also. We can connect the core of LVDT to the diaphragm, and if we are applying the sound wave on it, the pressure wave on it, it is going to vibrate, and due to those vibrations, the fluctuations in the core position is going to take place. So in these three examples, we are able to understand that with the help of another primary sensors, and if we are getting combined with the LVDT as a secondary sensor, we are able to make use of physical parameters. So that's how sensors and their application in the industrial instrumentations are going to take place. And moving forward to the another merits of LVDT, it is going to have a higher sensitivity of 40 volt per mm, and higher sensitivity states that if there is a small variations in the displacement also, it is going to generate the higher output voltage, because the sensitivity is rate of change of output divided by rate of change of input. And the final merit is it is going to have higher resolution. Resolution means the ability to detect the smaller increment, because the sensitivity is high, so it will be able to detect even the smaller increment as well. So these are all the some merits of LVDT and its practical application, and there are number of applications. Just for understanding purpose, I have correlated sensors with the industrial instrumentation. So now let us move forward with the dynamic characteristics of LVDT. And now we'll have a look of frequency domain analysis of LVDT, and by doing so, we'll be able to understand that how actually LVDT is going to respond for the different frequencies of input which we are going to provide as a displacement. So before jumping into our detail analysis, first let us have a look of few basic concept that if there is only one inductor of inductance L and the current across current in the inductor passing through it is I of t, so the voltage difference across the inductor can be given as VL is equal to L di of t by dt. This is something very common which we already know. So the main thing which we have to focus on is mutual inductance. So if there is a primary coil and the inductance I am giving as LP and there is another coil, secondary coil, so if the current in the primary coil is varying with respect to time as I of t, so due to the variation in the current in the primary coil, the concept of mutual inductance is going to come into the picture and the voltage output at the secondary coil is going to get generated, which can be given as M into d I of t by dt, where I of t will be the current variation in the primary coil and M will be the mutual inductance. So that's what the main difference between the self inductance and the mutual inductance. In the self inductance, the current of own coil itself is going to generate the voltage output, whereas in the case of mutual inductance, the current variation in the primary coil is going to give the voltage output at the secondary coil. So understanding the concept of self and mutual inductance, we are able to understand the voltage outputs, how we can write the voltage expression. And now let us write the KVL in the closed path in the primary coil. So in the primary coil, if we write the KVL starting from this point, if we go in the clockwise direction, the voltage difference is minus E excitation of T plus, and I am taking the resistance of primary coil as RP. So using Ohm's law, we can write the voltage difference as IR, so IP of T into RP plus voltage difference across the primary inductor, and the inductance is given as self inductance LP, so the voltage difference will write using this particular formula, plus LP d IP of T by dt. And as we started from this point, so minus E excitation of T plus RP IP plus L di by dt, we have come to this particular point back. So the summation of voltages in a closed path is going to be zero. So that's what a KVL in a closed path. So we are end up with IP RP plus LP DIP of T by dt is equal to E excitation of T. So this I will take as equation number one. And now the second thing we have to know about the E secondary 1 of T and E secondary 2 of T. So E secondary 1 of T, using the concept of mutual inductance, the current in the primary coil is IP of T. So the voltage is going to come using this formula is equal to M1. The mutual inductance of secondary one is as M1. So M1 D I primary of T by dt, because in the case of mutual inductance, we have to take the current of primary coil, and E excitation 2 of T is equals to mutual inductance 2 d IP of T by dt, because in the both the coils the mutual inductance is happening due to the current in the primary coil. So we are taking IP of T and IP of T. So this I am giving the equation number 2, and this I am naming as equation number 3. So using equation number 1, 2 and 3, we can simplify our expression. First make note of it, then I'll drop that part. So we'll apply the Laplace transform in the equation number first. So Laplace transform of IP of T will be IP of S into RP plus Laplace transform of LP DIP of T by DT. So LP is constant, and Laplace transform of IP is if I of IP of T is I of S, so L DIP of T, L I am not taking, DIP of T by DT is going to be S I of S. So I'll write it as LP IP of S, S IP of S is equal to E excitation of S. So the Laplace transform of IT is I of S, and the Laplace transform of DIP by DT is S IP of S. and Laplace transform of E excitation of T is E excitation of S, and our output of our interest is E difference is equal to E secondary 1 of T minus E secondary 2 of T. Because we are using series opposition idea, so our output will be difference of secondary coil 1 minus secondary coil 2. So this we can write as E differentiation of S, again the Laplace transform. So E S1 of S minus E S2 of S. So E S1 of S, the Laplace transform of this particular equation is M1 into SIP of S minus M2 into SIP of S. So E difference of S is going to come out as M1 minus M2 into SIP of S. So as I mentioned, the LVDT is going to work on the concept of mutual inductance. So as we can see, the mutual inductance term is going to come in the output expression. And now using this equation and this equation, we will try to establish the relation between E difference of S and E excitation of S. Because the dynamic characteristics is whatever excitation, like what frequency of excitation you are giving, for that particular frequency, how the output is going to vary. So that we have to analysis, and then only we will be able to understand the dynamic characteristics. So now let's establish the connection between output and input. So E difference of S, let me write it here itself. So from here we can write IP of S into RP plus LPS is equal to E excitation of S. So from here IP I can write it as E excitation of S divided by RP plus LPS. So I'll put this IP at this point. So E difference of S is going to be M1 minus M2 into S E excitation of S divided by RP plus LP of S. So E differentiation, difference of X divided by E excitation of X will be M1 minus M2 divided by RP. This is going to be constant, and at the top it will be S, and I have taken RP from common from denominator, so this will become 1 plus LP by RP into S. So this is nothing but K into S by 1 plus tau S. So K is going to be a constant, M1 minus M2 by RP, and tau is going to be another constant, LP by RP. So we can understand that if we are giving the LVDT as input as E excitation of S, and the output we are taking as E differentiation, difference of X. So E difference of X divided by E excitation of S, this is going to give the transfer function output divided by input, Laplace transform of output divided by Laplace transform of input, and it is going to come in this fashion, K into S by 1 plus tau S. And we can directly see this is going to be a high pass filter, because the Laplace transform of low pass filter is K by tau S plus 1, whereas in the case of high pass filter, it is going to be KS by tau S plus 1. So by doing the frequency domain analysis, we are able to understand that the dynamic characteristics of LVDT is of high pass filter, and if we apply the frequency of input as higher frequencies, we are going to get the good amount of response instead of we are using it for lower frequencies. So that's the basic idea about dynamic characteristics. If in detail also, if you require me to do the derivation in like doing the magnetic plot and phase plot, and then we'll be able to analyze at higher frequencies what actually is happening. So that can be done later on, but for as of now, this much idea is sufficient enough. So that's all for today. If you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment section, and thank you.